to be talking matters programming, and with me is someone who has an experience in programming, having worked for different media houses. He is none other than our very own from Daystar University. His name is Adams Munene. Adams, welcome.
Thank you so much. It's okay.
Now, before we start getting into matters programming, how about you just let us know about who you are?
Well, we start with my name. My full name is Joy Adams Munene. In 2011, I got an opportunity to work with a European company as an intern. My internship, I usually tell people I did my internship online, and that meant that I did a lot of research about Kenyan media. My assignments were to look at the programming of Kenyan media stations and the year of establishment, the media owners, their audience, demographics, and for me that was a very good opportunity. It was a 4 month opportunity, and by the end of the 4 months, of course, I was ready to go back to school to finish up. Yeah, that was my first encounter with programming and doing a lot of research, you know, trying to get different programming schedules from KTN, NTV, all media houses. And I also discovered that we had like 27 TV channels in Kenya, TV stations in Kenya by then, and 96 radio stations.
Wow.
By 2011.
Okay. One of the duties of a programmer is to do research. Because for you to program or to put to slot a particular program somewhere,
yeah,
you need to be knowing where what your competitor is airing at such and such a time.
Yeah. One thing about programming is if you're a programmer, you're like a chef. No, you prepare different menus.
Okay.
And so we say programming is like food, and there's an issue of convenience.
Yeah.
There's an issue of quantity, and there's an issue of quality. So whenever you're making food, you have to look at those things.
Yeah.
So when you program, you have to look at research, because you need to come up with a good content.
Yeah.
You have to look at the finances, because for you to produce good and quality stuff, you need finances. And there are times when you have to program for convenience. So
for convenience.
Not quality and not quantity. There are times we need to look at convenience. Convenience means your programming in favor of our medias. Like, convenience means there isn't enough content, so what do you do?
Oh.
you have to program in a way that our medias will still run without enough content. I mean, it's a little bit hard, but now that's why you become creative.
It's one of the critiques that I've read about Kenyan media is a lack of content.
Yes. Lack of content.
The fact that there's so much borrowed from the West. Us, we just watch stuff that is 10, 20 years old.
Actually, that's a major challenge for all TV stations across the globe. Programming like local content. They don't have local content. And if you see, like, what DSTV is trying to do is, DSTV is trying to now, they've discovered that giving us Western content is not enough, so they decided to come up with different programs that are local, that they can fund, and that they can air locally. So that way they can maintain their business going, and I think that is the way. We need to program local content, and we need to invest in that. Unfortunately, most media houses are not willing to invest. Why?
Yeah.
Because of market trends. Their market share has gone, has decreased over time. Because a long time ago, or 3 years ago, when we used to have these TV stations, you know, getting a lot of finances from advertising, that is gone because of migration to digital, which means most people can now have own TV stations and they can stream content, so it means they have to compete very well for them to remain in the market, so they don't have money to invest in programming. So the only company that will survive is the company that will invest a lot of money. 2 years ago, there's a company by the name Starwiz, or what is There's a Chinese company that has invested $6 billion in Kenya to work on
content. If you're a media house, a Kenyan media house, you should be looking at survival.
You should be looking at investing large amount of money for you to be able to survive. So what they've done is their $6 billion investment is to take care of the local content that will target Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, and some of East Africa countries that speak Swahili. So they're looking at Swahili language as a language that has a lot of people who speak Swahili. So what they're doing is they're translating even soap operas into Swahili. And so they have these softwares to transcribe and change the language to a local language so that they see how whether they can target the locals. So, I mean, it's a huge investment.
How many weeks did you do of programming in NTV? I saw on your CV.
Yeah.
A couple of weeks.
I did programming for, usually a month, a year's like 51 to 52 weeks.
Based on that experience, what is some of the market trends that is getting your attention? What are some of the market trends that you know?
Okay, what I can say is, okay, number one, I don't own a TV.
Yeah.
Even if I program for TV, that's a fact. Reason being is internet. I can stream online. I can watch any TV station, whichever time I want. So the issue is, due to technology advancement, we are having people acquiring content in new ways. You know, you don't have to sit home for you to watch. You don't have to rush home to watch 7 p.m. news. You can do that over your phone if you have access to Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
So the trends that we're having is, the trends that we're having are people or media houses, they're investing more on internet and streaming softwares so that they're able to reach people using tabs, people using mobile phones, and people using other gadgets.
I read a quote from the head of DSTV Africa. And she was saying one of the platforms that are keeping her awake at night is Netflix.
Yeah, Netflix. Because you know what Netflix does, eh?
Yeah.
It's an entertainment company. So what they do, they have a website,
yeah,
and they have servers where they load their content and they stream their content. And so what they've done is, for the last 3 years, they've been talking to these production companies in the US, in Hollywood, to acquire content, and once they acquire that content, other companies cannot acquire. So basically they sign up and they get prime content. So that's how they are able to compete with DSTV, because they have content that even DSTV doesn't have access to. So it means if there's a program running on Netflix, there isn't such program running on other TV station. So
because
which,
they own the rights.
Yeah, because they've taken the rights. Yeah, so which is what DSTV used to do to other companies, and now they're getting someone to beat them at their own game. But also Amazon Prime is another streaming service offered by Amazon company, and it's also competing with Netflix. But now the difference with Amazon and Netflix is Amazon you stream.
Yeah.
So means if you miss the time for streaming, you miss the program. But for Netflix, you can have access to any program anytime.
As a programmer, this is one of those worrying things. The fact that, you know, you as your programming so that you can get the audience, so that you can stay in business, and yet there's someone who brings convenience to watching television.
Yeah, actually I think the future of TV is internet, and that future is with us now. Because you can stream even a video from your phone using Periscope, which is offered by Twitter. You can stream using YouTube just with your DSLR camera. So the future of TV is anyone is able to stream their content now. So TV stations have to up their game.
All this technology,
yes.
My concern is the Africanism of television.
Yeah, I mean, for the last couple of years, we've had people done like very good movies, good content. Look at another streaming service offered by a Nigerian company called Eco TV.
Mm.
Eco TV streams Nigerian content only. They don't stream the West. They stream Nigerian content only. And it's very popular streaming service. Even most Kenyans and Africans, they are subscribing to the service. It's around, I think, $5.
$5.
Yeah. So I don't know whether it's per month or per year, but yeah, per year is a little bit expensive. But what is happening is, Nigerians, they sell their stories and they sell their culture, they sell their values, and they're making good money out of that.
Yeah, I admire Nigerians in a way.
And so for us Kenyans, we've been unable to sell our culture and our content to even the rest of the world. We are not even selling it to our locals. If you look at the local programs that we have in Kenya, you can just count. There are very few.
Adams, it should be frustrating for you, you know, working for a programming department. You really want to keep
it was very frustrating, because at times we used to source for content, yeah, and then we bring the producers on board,
yeah,
and then we meet the managers for NTV, yeah, and they say, we're going to pay like 300 for that program, and the producer says, if you're not paying me 500, I'm walking away. I'll give you a very good example with another program called Tujuana.
Yeah.
It started at KTN, right?
Yeah.
And then NTV was able to pay more money, yeah, it was moved to NTV. NTV couldn't keep it, Mnet paid more money. And the program moved to Mnet, yeah. So it's an issue of, are you willing to invest?
Okay, that's a good point to move on to the challenges that you,
yeah,
face as a programmer.
Yeah.
What are some of those challenges that you were experiencing?
Okay, I mean, one of the challenges as a programmer, when you don't have enough content, what do you do? You're forced to repeat programs. I'll give you a very good example of a TV station that I'm happy at least is dead by now.
It's dead.
Yeah, it's QTV. QTV,
yeah,
used to give people junk because they used to repeat these Nigerian movies after every 3 days. They're repeating a movie. Now, that wasn't healthy. So
yeah,
it was unsustainable. And the thing that made NTV withstand all those challenges,
yeah,
is because we have local programs on NTV, we have a lot of news, we have a lot of talk shows, so this keeps the TV going. But for QTV, there wasn't much. And so those programs were very unsustainable, and after every 1 week you would repeat content, which wasn't healthy enough. It was very bad. At least they decided to shut it down. But even for NTV and KTN, they're still struggling. I mean, Citizen has made a big step, in acquiring local programs. They have a lot of local programs, but still they are not yet. We haven't achieved even 30%. And the government's requirement is 60% local. I don't know what will happen. Maybe one day government will shut them down if they don't have local content.
And probably, alternatively, government would probably just, tone down or just decide not to apply that rule, 60%.
Yeah, the government might do that or not, but whether it does it or not,
yeah,
the TV stations are suffering because they're not willing to invest. And what is happening now is because we're having more people going online. I'll give you a very good scenario. I'll give you a scenario of the mainstream media versus the new media. And this played out very well in the US, the last US elections that we had. But the point was the new media has taken over.
Is there a way in which new media and the mainstream media can somehow convert and save the main media, from
the mainstream media is trying to adopt ways of survival,
yeah,
by having their content available online or streaming,
yeah,
but the new media is giving them a lot of challenges, because when we have someone like Alex Jones, he's a TV and radio presenter in the US, he has his own company called Alex Jones, so he's very popular. And he's not mainstream. He's like the only guy, and he's employed a couple of other guys. So if he wants to run his agendas, he'll do it very comfortably. He has no one to control. He doesn't have editor-in-chief. He doesn't have those editors who We even sometimes make it worse for many houses.
Yeah. Would you as a programmer now have to look at, you know, what is some of those strategies that you employ so that you bring your audience on board as opposed to simply living on the ivory tower, as you mentioned?
Yeah. I think Nation Media Group is a little bit trying on that. They've started now recording videos, posting them online. I'll give it up for them. And but what I'm saying is, broadcasting is very expensive. And streaming over the internet and or sharing your, having your media, your content being accessed via the internet is a little bit cheaper. So these media houses, they're still using a lot of money on transmitters and other things and servers. So what is happening is they are using more and they are getting less.
Yeah.
If you take your camera now, you're able to stream your content via even maybe free Wi-Fi. So that's the difference. You're not even using a lot of money. As long as you have the gadget, you're ready to go. As long as you have a phone that is 20 megapixels, you're ready to go on Periscope and stream an event. That's how easy it is.
Yeah.
So now what it means is they have to readjust quickly if they don't want to be thrown out of business.
In conclusion, with the benefit of hindsight,
does
programming have a future?
Programming has a future.
But that future?
And it kind has of a future only if.
Yeah.
Only if. Because you can program for the internet, which is what, like, I do. If I get like 10 articles in a day, I choose which to publish and which not to do. And it's based on who are my audience. Am I giving them the best? If I get an article or a press release and I feel it's not worth it to my audience, I won't give them. I won't just have junk on the website because I want to have more information out. No, I wouldn't do that. But you see, mainstream media, if they get a lot of stuff, they still a little bit for, maybe for newspaper or even online, they post all junk there. But you know, you have to make sure that you filter. You have to filter. And now what I'm saying is for programmers, they have a bigger challenge. And they have to adopt the new technology and they have to work their way. But there's still a chance for programming. Programming will never die. TV station, TV broadcasting will never die. Only the technology is changing. So if they adopt that,
then there's a chance.
There's a chance to survive.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Adams, for the interview. And thank you also for staying with us. Until next time.